It's my pleasure to introduce to you some of the most urgent, systematic, and insightful political writers working today. All of our speakers have been, or currently are, editors for The Nation magazine. Since 1865, The Nation, in its own words, has been a money-losing, troublemaking, dissenting, establishment-questioning magazine that, in the words of one of its founders, has the faculty of seeing through the tribe. Past editors have included Albert Einstein, Martin Luther King Jr., Hunter S. Thompson, Bertrand Russell, among many others. Joining us today are, Richard Lingemann, Katrina van den Heuvel, and Victor Novosky, and their latest endeavor is The Nation Guide to the Nation, a leftist handbook for sightseeing, going to college, and shopping at the supermarket. Richard Lingemann is a senior editor at The Nation. His books include Small Town America, A Narrative History, 1620 to the Present, as well as An American Journey, Theodore Dreiser, a two-volume biography. Katrina van den Heuvel is The Nation's editor-in-chief and publisher, a frequent guest on MSNBC, CNN, PBS, and other networks. She recently appeared on ABC News Roundtable program This Week, debating Karl Rove and George Will on the direction and ideas of the Republican Party. Depending on which YouTube clips you quote, the result of her heated exchange with Rove was that she double-served, smacked down, or my favorite, owned him as he attempted to derail her arguments with misrepresentation and deflection. Victor Novosky is a publisher emeritus of The Nation. He was the magazine's editor from 1978 to 1985 and publisher and editorial director from 1995 to 2005. He has served as a Guggenheim Fellow and received a National Book Award and a George Polk Award. He currently serves as director of the George Delacorte Center for Magazine Journalism at Columbia University, and is a regular commentator on the public radio program Marketplace. Please help me welcome the editors of The Nation magazine.
Should I?
Go first.
You go ahead, Vic.
Okay. So we're glad to be here, and as you just heard, The Nation was founded in 1865, the year the Civil War ended, and in the magazine business, survival is the ultimate test of success. Therefore, The Nation, which is America's oldest weekly magazine and has survived where magazines like Life and Look and Collier's and the Saturday Evening Post with circulations in the millions went under, therefore The Nation, by our understanding, is America's most successful magazine, even though it's lost money for virtually every one of its 144 years of publication. And its secret of survival is that it lost money all those years. It's as much a cause as a magazine. And you heard a list of fancy contributors. The interesting thing to me is that The Nation was the first to publish people like Ralph Nader when he was still a student at the Harvard Law School, Jimmy Baldwin, Martin Luther King before he became famous. He was, when he was had his own congregation in Atlanta, was doing an annual civil rights audit for The Nation. So it has been a presence and a countrywide presence, even though it's a tiny circulation magazine, and as you'll hear from Katrina and Richard, it's as much a state of mind as a magazine. And this all came home to me one day when I came back to the office. The Nation's offices are now at 33 Irving Place, and I came back, and there was a message on my voicemail. And the message was from a woman whom I'd met once, maybe 10 or 15 years earlier, from the South. And she, and well, I'm going to read you what the message said. And she was in her late 60s. I need to ask a favor of you. I'm stuck in Abbeville, Louisiana, and I want to move. But I want to move somewhere where I can see a Democrat before I die. It occurs to me that you might be able to rummage up a place where people are actually subscribers to the Nation, where I'd have somebody to talk to. I don't want their names or anything. I just want a town where there are a few kindred souls. And then she added, if you could call around noon, I'd be grateful. I'm about to cut the grass. So this to me was emblematic of all those folks who are out there who see this as a meeting place for kindred souls. And I'm going to turn this over to Katrina, who, as you have heard, is the editor and publisher of the magazine, and who actually came to the Nation as an intern and is one of the great advertisements for the Nation intern program, which is one of the great intern programs in the magazine business in this country. And Katrina, why don't you tell us how we got here?
I thought the order was going to be Richard, but that's
I'm sorry.
Fine. No, it's okay. I always like to Google before I go somewhere, before I meet someone to find out about them. So, but I couldn't do that here because it would have been a mass Google. But thank you for having us. Victor talked a little bit about the history of the magazine. And what strikes me, even while at The Nation today, thenation.com, our website, is really an active and integrated part of our community and our work and our ideas, that there is still a place, even with our laptops and our computer, for meeting people, for exchanging ideas and having fun and thoughts. And this book is part of what Victor was saying, is finding communities around this country, meeting like-minded kindred souls. The book has been marketed a little bit with, you know, in a good way, as a left progressive. I think of it more as kind of for independent independent spirits who want to engage others. And one group that has been helping us, and Richard can say more, helping us get the book out across the country, from Butte, Montana, to Salt Lake City, to Missoula, Montana, to Seattle, to Portland, is a group called Living Liberally or Drinking Liberally. You may know of it, but they have about 70 groups around the country, and they're connected through the internet, but they also use the internet to then say, hey, let's go meet at a local community saloon, bar, bookstore. And this book is filled with meeting places like that. And in that sense, it's, as Richard can tell you, it is this kind of cross between the 1960s Whole Earth Catalog meets Zagat's, meets A Thousand Places to End One's Good Life, or Live One's Good Life. The other, I think, impetus for this book, and it emerged, it's an idea, as Richard will tell you, it's something Victor's been thinking about for more than a decade. It's something he's wanted to do for more than a decade. But it seemed like as this country was on the cusp of real change, it was a moment to kind of map a different country. Not that it's out there or fringe. In fact, I could make a case that the alternative is more the mainstream today. But it's bookstores and internet sites and media and radio stations, independent food markets. Some of you probably go to the Green Market at Union Square. This book has co-ops and green markets around this country. And it's this sense of that kind of community, which is part of the moment we're living in, I think, where people are looking for alternatives to the mainstream as it's also confronting this economic crisis. I wanted to just say two more words before turning it over to Richard. One thing about The Nation, as Victor said, is that it is as much a cause as a magazine. It is, if you track The Nation, and one thing we've done over the last few years is we've digitized the entire run of the magazine going back to 1865. And that was a bold effort. It is an alternative history guide. It's more fun than a textbook, but it is mapping an alternative America, an alternative world. And this book, in its heritage trail, in its guide to sites you might not otherwise have on your map, like Woody Guthrie's home, Bob Dylan's home, or where some of the big strikes in our country's history took place, Haymarket strike. It's an alternative sense of this country, not about the great leaders who still fill our textbooks as they should, but about the ordinary people and struggles which really make up this country. And in that sense, it becomes, and I think bookstores grapple with where to put it, it's a travel guide, an alternative travel guide, an alternative history, as well as a guide to lifestyle and a guide to fun things. The fun things Richard can tell you more about, but one thing I love is like the 10 great anthems of the left or the 10 great protest songs. I mean, Sam Cooke, Change Is Gonna Come, Patti Smith, Power to the People. It has 25 great left mysteries. It has our film critic, Stuart Klawan's, a list of the great independent left films of the 20th into the 21st century. So those are fun. I love lists, and they're easily accessible in here. There is also, last point on the history, you know, a lot of talk about the New Deal these days. A lot of talk about stimulus money going to artists and to the creative community. And there's a whole section in here about the Federal Arts Project of the New Deal period of the 30s, Thomas Hart Benton, Ben Shawn. And I think that's going to resonate more and more in these next months as jobs need to be created. And the creative community, which you're a part of, needs to be factored into that and thinking about how to engage the creative minds. There is also, and I'll stop, a really interesting section on the internet and independent internet sites. Truthdig, you know, talkingpointsmemo.com probably, but Feministing. But I would, you know, check those out, and I will turn it over to Richard and welcome your questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Katrina. Thanks for having us, all you Google folk. We're glad to be here.
Maybe I should say Richard did the heavy lifting on this book. Katrina and I did the introduction, but
you've gotten the context of it. Now we'll get down to the nitty gritty, which is I did write it with a lot of help. It was a collective effort. I mean, it's a socialist, red, subversive publication. But anyway, I'm trying to bait the right wing on this. But I did have from these interns that Katrina mentioned and was that they helped me with the research, and also our nation people, our nation community. We tapped this resource. These were all things that were prospective when Victor was envisioning the book and I was working with him and writing proposals trying to get a publisher for it. And Vintage Book was very completely simpatico with the idea. But a lot of these things turned out. We found even before we started on the book that in an issue we did on, I think it was on green markets, and people submitted their favorite green markets. We asked the readers, and we got a big response. So we thought using that base, that this would be kind of our circle, and then there would be larger concentric circles on the left. And of course, it is about the left in America, and also independent thinkers everywhere. So we got the publisher and we started outlining the books and the research topics. And I think first was bookstores. That was another thing we tested in our magazine. And, you know, we had about 200 or so bookstores from all our readers. And so it was a question of going through them and selecting. And we wanted to keep true to this idea of kind of relationship, left-oriented relationship, and each category is a little different. Bookstores, you'll find that a lot of them serve as community forums these days, especially the indies, but also the big ones like Barnes & Noble by holding author
talks and readings and so on, and then they have discussion periods. So we found the people suggested, and we narrowed down, and we found a lot of bookstores, these little bookstores and big bookstores that were acting as forums for ideas where people could meet, and books are one of our last refuges of ideas, I guess. But you know, we covered other areas like history, and which it seemed to me is important to remember our heritage on the left, and so this book is like a trail that stretches from. It starts in Boston with the Sacco Vanzetti trial there, and the Heritage Trails in Boston, and this Heritage Trail continues throughout the book, and it's interspersed throughout the book. And then we also looked for this connective tissue of the left community, and the media is very important there. And so I wrote up all these left media examples, and some are been around, as well established, like The Nation and The Progressive out in Wisconsin, and In These Times out in Chicago, and some are new, and they're very indie in the indie sense, and they have an anarchist background. Some of them originated in the anti-WTO protests in Seattle. So they're part of the history of the left, too, and on. And, of course, even as we were preparing this and the Obama campaign was moving ahead, the Internet became a real factor in politics and Move On and all these others. So we had to have a section on the Internet. And then we, The Nation magazine, had a special issue on food and local food, and Alice Waters had edited that. So we started compiling restaurants where they have local food and serve natural food. And this is another way that reflects our values, just our environment, our green values, the local food and the green markets and so on. So we compiled lists of those, there are thousands of green markets, so we had our readers suggest their favorite ones, and some were very evocative, talking about a woman who wrote in about the green market in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, where every Saturday everybody, the whole community gathers almost and meets and talks to each other. And so there's all these different things. And so I found this, you know, a great learning experience, a connection with America from our readers, from our editors and writers. And so we hope this can keep going, and we can maintain a web presence and get more ideas for perhaps another volume eventually. But we do have a web presence where you can suggest the things that I omitted, and you can take me to task for that. But anyway, that's more or less how it was done collectively, and I wrote it all up, and Vintage... brilliantly published it, and we had, and so this is the result. And I think it does emblemize the left community. I think of a big map of America with these little lights lighting up all over, and that's people all over the country who are dedicated, progressive, liberal, independent-minded people. And that's a hopeful sign for America. These people were who rallied behind Obama. So I've talked enough here. So thanks for your attention, and thanks for coming.
So if you have any questions for us, or observations, or denunciations, or whatever. If not, Richard, you may want to give your favorite readings. One thing about the book that hasn't been mentioned is you know, is the way it looks. And in every section of this book, there's an introductory illustration by Ed Koren, who's the guy who does those fuzzy animal pictures, which you'll know as soon as you see it. And he's interesting to us, in addition to being one of many really talented artists who do things for the magazine. We have a circle of shareholders, we call it the Circle of 100, and who have an annual meeting. They just had one over the phone this year, but they all get a stock certificate. And I was able to tell them that the value of your shares may go down, but because Ed Koren drew the stock certificate and numbered it and signed it, the value of your stock certificate is going to go up. So this is our value that we're able to pass on to them. So anyway.
So.
Hi.
Yeah.
Hi.
Well, thanks for introducing the book. It looks really interesting. I have a question. It's not directly about the book, but I know that the left has kind of been taking this humongous beating for a really long time. And I'm just wondering where you folks see the left as a movement going in the next years. And
good.
Here's one of the leaders.
You know, I think we'd all agree that there are many lefts. There are lefts. There's an, but in this last period, it seems to me this country has shifted in a direction, moving toward some of the left principles which the nation has espoused over the years, slowly, but non-military solutions to problems, less reliance on foreign oil, a more just economic system. These are in play. These are on an agenda, haven't been for many years. Concern for human rights, series of issues. Now, around the world, I think that the left, particularly in Latin America, we cover the world too, that there are models around the world where we can learn, and that there is a vibrancy on the left that didn't exist 25 years ago. So we're trying to make connections with people around the world and in this country. I think this book, as Richard and Victor said, shows that there is a culture, if not of the left, but of alternative, independent, non-mainstream lifestyles that goes unreported. I think our media, by the way, is in flux. There's a crisis of the newspaper industry, which is both sad to witness, but out of crisis also comes opportunity for places like The Nation or alternative media. And for too long, the media hasn't paid attention to a major part of this country, which you can describe as left or progressive. Someone like the woman Victor mentioned, who's living in a part of the country where she may not hear or see ideas and feel isolated. The internet, I think, has played a good role, and I'll stop, but it has played a good role because too often people, if they're in their communities and don't see like-minded people, might feel they're crazy. And how do I become part of a community? People need to see that there are others, and there are. They may not be in the streets, which has often been a defining part of a left. This book tracks marches on Washington over the years, but there are other ways of both protest, and I think the hopeful part about the left today is that we are going from protest to proposals, because there is a sense that there's an opening in this country to be heard, to be listened, and have a president whose great strength, and we have to hold him to it, is he was a community organizer, and he believes that real change comes from below, from organized people, from movements, and from people pushing for change. So I'm hopeful, sober, but hopeful about the possibilities of some real transformational change, not only in this country, but in the world.
I would also say that the implication of this book, in answer to your question, it's not, this isn't a hortatory book. It's not a piece of propaganda. It's, but the implication is very optimistic in terms of your question, in the following way. Someone once said in the 1940s, when they were describing The Nation magazine, that it was a magazine for the permanent minority. And when I heard that, I said to myself, do I want to be in the permanent minority? That doesn't sound too good. You want to be in the majority. But the more I thought about it, you know, The Nation was founded by people in and around the abolitionist movement, and the abolitionist movement turned out to be ahead of its time. The Nation has been, as Katrina said, a fighter for equal rights, human rights, civil liberties. During the years of the bleakest years of a segregationist country, The Nation was ahead of its time. And so on all of these, if on all of these themes, as you go through it, and you see that in historical circumstance after historical circumstance, there has been a movement on some of these issues, there's many other things waiting to be done. That to me is another hopeful fact that is in between the pages and in between the lines of The Nation Guide to the Nation.
One last thing. Sometimes I think the left gets a bad rap because we're viewed as like too earnest, too sincere. This book has a lot of pleasure in it. It has a lot of fun in it. Whether it's Bush, Billionaires for Bush, the kind of old, if you remember, like yippie, subversive, impish, prankish tradition, which is serious. It also has, you know, unionized strip clubs or the Smitten Kitten, worker-owned sex toys run by feminists in Minneapolis. It has drinking places. You know, I mean, so there's that as well as the other piece. Richard, I'm sorry.
I think it is true that we have, Victor and I have been in a long time, and Katrina too, at The Nation, and we have, in some sense, felt we were out of it, and now we see our language getting into the national dialogue much more than it used to, and which is fine, and we believe it's right, and I think I'm kind of a history buff, and it's good to think, remember the history of the left, and so that's why that's in here too, because it's a great history and it's a people's history. We've got Howard Zinn right up front here talking about how important it is to preserve these places that mark the people's struggle, you know, for unions and for the 8-hour day. One of our great backers was the late Studs Terkel, a great fan, and I can't tell a story like he did, but I read a story he was telling about how he was going to work, and he always took the bus, and he was in Chicago, you know, going to this radio station, and there were this yuppie couple that came up, and he says, I'm talking to all the people there like I always do. And so he started talking to them, and she's carrying Vanity Fair and so on, and he's carrying the Wall Street Journal. So he says, somehow he gets around to, how many hours a day do you work? And the guy says, 8 hours. And he said, do you know that five guys were hanged so that you could work for an 8-hour day? And he's talking about the Haymarket riots, which these people were unjustly hanged, but that was in the 1880s in Chicago. That was a rally for the 8-hour day, and that's how these things come about, and through struggle and through argument and democratic process, and so that's Studs Terkel's way of saying how important history is. We've got to remember these things. So I just want to remember, and he's in this book too, and he writes about Chicago, and I'm glad we got him. He was a wonderful man. Anyway, thanks for your question.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thoughts? Richard.
Should I read?
Sure.
When I read,
give me your favorite entry.
Well, I could read Stedman's entry, I guess.
Sure.
We have a section in there, My Favorite American Place, with various writers from Francis Fitzgerald and Mike Davis. A lot of people give their favorite place, and that's kind of an upbeat feature. And instead said, Chicago is, of course, my favorite city. Nelson Algren said of it, like loving a woman with a broken nose, you may well find lovelier lovelies, but never a lovely so real. It is a home of labor battles royal. And he said, he mentioned, here it was, the eight-hour day became part of the world's vocabulary. Four men were hanged in an obscene farcical trial. Yet we finally achieved the Republic Steel Massacre on Memorial Day, 1937. It was during a picnic that Chicago cops shot 10 picnickers in the back. Yet Steel was organized. And he goes on, Chicago's God is Janus, the two-headed one. Jane Addams, Al Capone, Samuel Insull, Mayor Harold Washington, versus the hacks who sabotaged his every effort on behalf of the working folks. Ricardo's was a great restaurant. Here it was that writers, actors, activists of old stripe gathered. It was Ricardo who broke the loop color line. The role Humphrey Bogart played in Casablanca was really our Ricardo. That he was called Rick was a happy accident. And of course, the lobby of the Wells Grand Hotel, where the arguments were definite and idiomatically eloquent. Finally, there was Bughouse Square, with its soapbox orators who cause us to laugh and to heckle, but mostly to think. Sorry. And there are various contributions throughout here. Well, shall I read about Joe Hill's ashes? Joe Hill, the great IWW organizer and songster. He was a predecessor to Woody Guthrie. This is about Joe Hill's ashes. Tradition holds he was executed in Salt Lake City. After Joe Hill was executed by firing squad for the robbery murder of a Utah shopkeeper in 1915, and the Wobblies always say he was innocent. He was framed by the union bosses, I mean by the copper bosses, sorry. His ashes were released to the winds on May 1st, 1916 by fellow Wobblies, as stipulated in his last will, composed on death row. Quote, let the merry breezes blow my dust to where some fading flowers grow. Perhaps some fading flowers then would come to life and bloom again. Actually, the Wobblies placed some of his ashes in envelopes and mailed them to every IWW branch. U.S. postal inspectors intercepted one envelope and impounded it as subversive remains. It was detained in FBI files for many years. Yet at the funeral of six miners killed in a 1927 riot by state police in Columbine, Colorado, some of Joe's ashes were reportedly sprinkled on the gravesites. And is told that one of the original IWW envelopes of ashes was sent to a Swedish labor union, which interred it in the wall of its headquarters. The building is now a public library, but Joe Hill's ashes abide. Flash forward to 1988. The living branch of the IWW, there still is an IWW active today in Chicago, obtained the ashes from the FBI without the original envelope warning of its subversive contents. The Socialist Monthly in these times asked readers to suggest how best to dispose of Joe Hill's remaining dust. The winning suggestion came from radical provocateur Abby Hoffman, who proposed that sympathetic radicals eat it. Folk singer Billy Bragg confirmed that while he was in Chicago, he was offered a pinch, which he swallowed, chased by a glass of beer. All these reports seem somehow appropriate to the restless spirit of Joe Hill.
Well, that's the sign that elsewhere in the book, when Paul Krasner, who edited the Realist magazine,
way back in the 60s and late 50s. He has written it on a little paragraph on the state of political satire, and he points out rarely has long reality has long been nipping at the heels of satire, and he takes it right up to the present day. Yeah. And my favorite paragraph in that is when he says, but lately reality has been outrunning satire. It wasn't a comedian who said there was a pair of dinosaurs on Noah's Ark. It was a creationist trying to reconcile the disconnect between science and religion. His unintentional joke was followed by an actual creationist museum with a caveman riding a dinosaur. So there it is.
Right. Yeah.
What's your favorite?
Well, I mentioned the lists in the book. I love the list and the anthems of the left. So we had Eric Alterman, our media columnist, and Danny Goldberg, a music producer who worked with Kurt Cobain, who works with Steve Earle today and others, kind of duke it out as to their top 10 fave. They couldn't work it out, but I'm going to read their top 10. They couldn't work it out, so we have sort of like Supreme Court dissenting briefs, Eric's choices and Danny's choices following on. But the top 10 songs upon which Eric and Danny agree: Patti Smith, People Have the Power; Marvin Gaye, What's Going On; Bob Marley and the Wailers, Get Up, Stand Up; The Rascals, People Gotta Be Free; Sam Cooke, A Change Is Gonna Come; U2, Pride in the Name of Love; Jefferson Airplane, Volunteers; Peter LaFarge, The Ballad of Ira Hayes; Jackson Browne, Before the Deluge; and James Brown, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. But this is where I hope we're getting some people sending us their faves, because it then goes on. Just talking one second on the state of the left, it was pretty moving to see Pete Seeger at that White House concert on the eve of the inauguration. And I don't know my music history well enough, but there was a part of his song which hadn't been sung for many years, a few lines which had sort of been censored in the previous version. Oh, there he was at the Lincoln Memorial singing it loud and proud about private property.
Yeah.
It's his collective property, but it was moving. He's turning 90 in May, and he's a longtime friend of the nation's. And he's on one of the lists, not on the main list, which is a call.
His picture's in here, too.
His picture, right.
You know, Seeger, as many of you may know, was a founding member of this great folk group, the Weavers, and then they were blacklisted during the McCarthy years. And Lee Hayes, who was another one of the Weavers, said, if it wasn't for the honor of the thing, I'd just as soon not have been blacklisted many years later. And I think what this is really the honor of the thing. It shows all these terrible things that happened, but people who resisted them and thought about it, and again, it comes to the question about the left, they prevailed in many cases, not in all cases, but in many cases they did. So it's an inspirational guidebook as well as a amusing one in parts.
I think it was conceived to exemplify the values on the left, and they cover a lot of areas as we've described, and I think that you get a synergy in this book among all the different items and categories, and you begin to, you get a feel of something living and something alive in our own times as well as the history, and so I think that was just one of the side benefits of this, and it's got ideas in it too. I mean, it may be ideas for making shoes without killing animals, you know, and values like that, or fair traded clothing. And there's stores that are listed here, but they all are carrying out these values, and they're showing how to do it. And of course, there's a whole section on think tanks, which that's all they do is think about what.
Right.
And they're also more activists these days, and they get involved in planning, and then they've got involved with planning for the new Obama administration. So There are all different working parts here on the left, which are on display, and I just recorded it, but it was very fascinating for me even to just to learn these things about these organizations.
But just bringing it back home, if you just went on our virtual history tour in this book, The Heritage Trail, you'd learn more about the neighborhood you're working in, because we have the history of the Union, the Green Market, we have Tompkins Square Park, we have Stonewall Inn.
Yeah.
We have Judson Church.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a nice, grounded in that way. There's a reality to it as well as, I think, the inspirational piece.
Mm-hmm.
There's a sense of... And finally, a longtime contributor to The Nation, Gore Vidal, I think he coined the expression, it's in here, that he talked about the U.S., the United States of amnesia. And this book is an antidote to that, as is The Nation week in, week out. And from history comes both inspiration and lesson in life. So.
Yep.
And it's fun to dip into.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Thank you guys so much for being here.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.